How many houses do you think do we need in this country? I tell you what, the problem is, you see, that the government has got this insane plan, right, to build 1.2 million homes in 5 years, which would be great, except it looks like another broken promise. And that means the housing crisis is going to get even worse because we're not building anything like the houses we need for the government's other crazy plan, its immigration intake, taking in nearly 1 million immigrants in just 2 years. Now, one problem here is a lack of builders. Another is the latest insolvency data that shows nearly 2,800 construction firms went bust or into receivership in the last financial year. 2,800, that's way up on the year before. And now look, the houses being built each year are way below what's needed each year for 5 years. And the banks are warning if the pace isn't if fast, if we don't in fact build a new home every 2 minutes, we're really going to have a housing crisis worse than this one. Joining me is the Chief Economist of the Housing Industry Association, Tim Reardon, who's looked at this stuff. Tim Reardon, thank you for your time. Listen, how many new houses do we need and how many are we actually building?
Well, the 1.2 million is a really important, ambitious, but achievable goal, and we're going to need to build at least that volume of homes over the course of the next 5 years to meet that underlying demand for new homes. And if we don't achieve that 1.2 million, we will continue to see rental price growth at that 10% and house price growth approaching that rate as well. As you mentioned, the strong levels of overseas migration are an important component to that underlying demand for housing. And from an industry perspective, what we have always sought on that front is stable and reliable migration, which of course is the inverse of what we've seen over the past couple of years, the boom bust cycle that the industry has gone through there. And you mentioned the insolvency data, and it is very important. But the boom bust cycle that the industry has been through for the past couple of years isn't what we would like to see. We would like to see stable and reliable migration pathways. And in regards to the insolvency topic you raised there, what we are seeing at the moment is really a shadow of last year's problems. The cash flow shortage that builders saw in 2022 is playing out in some of the official data at the moment. And also what we're seeing in that insolvency data, it isn't typically builders dealing with customers at the moment. It is the subcontractors dealing with builders that are now going through cash flow problems. That pass-through of that cash flow problem from builders through to subcontractors is the dynamic we're seeing in the market at the moment. And that's likely to probably get a little bit worse over the course of the next 3 months. I expect that to get to its worst in August or September this year before it starts to ease and go back to normal levels.
Yeah, and we haven't even talked about the fact that, you know, the high prices of building products at the moment is putting would put up some put off some consumers as well. But look, take the amazing immigration intake. You know, we added 2% to our population in just 1 year, which is just incredible. I don't know that any country in the West that's done something like that. We needed 220,000 houses just for the immigrants, not for the people, you know, to the natural growth rate in the country, just for immigrants. 220,000 houses. We built probably about 160,000, so many short of that.
Yes.
An 11-year low. I mean, what on earth are we going to do to turn that around to build the houses we need?
That's right. So we need to build about 100 to 120,000 homes per year just to meet that underlying demand of aging housing stock that needs replacing. And we know that from looking at countries such as Japan. They've gone 30 years without overseas migration. They build around about 1 million homes per year. And then on top of that, we do need to build now at least one home for every two migrants that arrive. And I think that those estimates that you're quoting there are still relatively conservative in terms of the build that we require. But even in the absence of migration, 2 years there without any migration, and the industry continued to operate at capacity, and the same is true, it's going to take us many years of increased home building to get to that point. In order to meet that underlying demand, what we can't do is to continue to tax housing at the rate we're taxing. Whether it's GST, stamp duty, all of the other tax imposts, just this year we've seen an increase in regulatory costs through the National Construction Code. We've also seen the New South Wales government and Queensland government increase taxes on foreign investors. And they're a really important component. Foreign investors don't live in Australia. They build houses that Australians live in and rent, and we're forcing them out of the market. And we can see the volume of apartments in Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane. It's around about half now of what it was 10 years ago before these taxes were introduced. So in order to build more homes, we do know that that coordination level from a federal government, we need state governments to reduce the tax impost they're imposing on homes and local councils to increase the supply of both greenfields and brownfields.
I don't know why you are so, maybe by nature an optimist, I like that, but I will bet you that 1.2 million doesn't come, we don't come within a cooee of building that many. Tim Reardon, thank you so much indeed for your time.